And he was he graduated in physics from the University of Granada first, and then that was 1995, and then afterwards he came immediately at work. Afterwards started Ingeniería Electrónica, so he's an electronic engineer in the same university. And so this is one of the characteristics, I would say, of the scientific profile of Aceituno, which is mixing a mixture of the physics and the interest also for astronomical instrumentation, and I would say not just astronomical, but scientific instrumentation in general. And afterward, he joined Palo Alto as in the astronomy group, and he has been since then working there. And he started a PhD in astronomy at the University of Granada. It was directed by José Luis Ortiz here from the IAEA in 2000 till 2005. So he has shown very clearly an interest for the development of astronomy, but he has participated in particular in the last, I would say, four years. It has been very difficult for Palo Alto, for the situation now. We are in a different situation, but it was very difficult. He has participated on the way that these astronomical achievements related to instrumentation have produced a change on the vision of the for the future and the perspective of Canada, in particular in relation to Carmenes, the experiment, in relation to panic, in relation to the last very important legacy projects. They were started with Alhambra and later with Khalifa, and other projects that are prepared for the future. So I'm stopping here. I would like to finish saying that if you are in this colloquium, you are the head, I would say, of a team, a very important team of astronomers and engineers, and that are working in Colorado. They are working very hard, and have been working very hard in the last years, and they are actually this is a way to pay a tribute, not only to you as a director, but a tribute to all Palo Alto, all the people of Palo Alto have been pushing very hard. And I know now they are actually pushing also very hard, fighting actually again for the observatory of for astronomy in Spain. So, up to you.
Okay, good morning everybody. Well, I've been requested just to give this talk in English. But if any time any one of you want to make the question in Spanish or something, just feel free to do it. Okay, thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you very much as well for the invitation to this this speech. I'm just going to talk, as Pepe said, about the current status of the Observatory of Palo Alto. I just want to focus on the highlights that we have got during the last 2 years. As you probably know, we suffered a very strong crisis since 2 years ago. We are still in this crisis, but we are moving on. The observatory didn't stop, fortunately, and we are getting very good results. And also, at the end of my talk, I will also give some guidelines about what the future could be for the observatory. And I'm nearly sure that the observatory will continue. I think that we are moving in the right direction. So during this talk, it will be split in different parts. But at the end, I hope that you have a clear idea what the current situation of the observatory is and what the future could be. I just want to also give the thanks to this institution, because in the last 2 years, of course, with the permission of the former directors of IAEA and Palo Alto, I'm very proud just to say that maybe now we have the strongest link between both institutions never ever. And I really hope that this situation is the same for the incoming years. because many decisions have to be taken, and many decisions we are taking as well. All of them, we are internally coordinated between our institution and as well with MPIA at Heidelberg. As you know, these two institutions are our reference institution to define the strategy for the observatory. And now the health of this relationship is very, very good. So for that reason, I just wanted to say say thank you as well to the institution. Let's start with a general overview that probably most of you already know about the history of CARA Alto. CARA Alto is an economic interest group that is formed by two institutions, two partnerships. One is the Max Planck Society and Consejo Superior de Investigaciones Científicas. Everything started in 1998. During 2 years, the site testing was made in different places around the Mediterranean Sea. And in 1972, the first agreement was achieved between the governments of Spain and the Federal Republic of Germany. This first agreement was valid until the end of 2003. In 1975, the first facility came to CARA Alto and was the 1.2 meter telescope. And in 1979, the first light for the 2.2 meter telescope happened. Also, the Schmidt camera was transferred from Hamburg to CARA Alto. And also the 1.5 Spanish telescope was built. That was the official inauguration of Centro Astronómico Hispano-Alemán. In 1984, the first light for the 3.5 also happened. As I told, in 2003, it finished the first agreement, and then a new one started in 2004, just to start with the joint operation of the observatory by the Max Planck Society and Consejo Superior de Investigaciones Científicas in the same manner, a 50-50%. This agreement will be valid until the end of 2018, where a new scenario must be prepared, and we are just working on that. As a special date in our history, I just want to mark here the arrival of Carmenes, because it's so far the most important instrument developed for the observatory. Okay, I told that CARA Alto is an economic association. Is something a little bit strange, but is our legal structure. But it also an ICTS. This is probably not well known by everybody, and I just want to spend some minutes here because it's very relevant for us. An ICTS is a singular scientific and technical infrastructure. It comes from Spanish Infraestructura Científico Técnica Singular. They are big facilities in Spain with big resources and equipment unique of its kind. And they are based on the state-of-the-art technical development that promote the knowledge and the technology transfer. There are a total of 39 ICTS in Spain, and 7 are devoted for astronomy. Maybe the most comprehensive definition about what an ICTS is given by Mineco, by the Minister of Economy. And let me read, because he said quite clear. ICTS is a singular scientific infrastructure and experimental vanguard tool unique in Spain due to its contents and performance, useful for the research, development, innovation system of our country, scientifically and technologically developed, essential in order to achieve specific research and or technology developments. So that its non-existent represent a limitation or loss of opportunities for the country, and whose construction and or conservation is mandatory and strategic. I think it's quite clear how important we are for the central government. The good thing just to be an ICTS is that there are special funding lines for them. In particular, the so-called Program FEDER 2014 and 2020, that is supported by the Spanish Ministry of Economy. The main aim is to enhance the scientific research and technological development and innovation. This is suitable only for ICTSs. And the actions supported are new developments, updates or improvement of existing facilities, and repairs of substitutions of elements of the map of infrastructure, We have already applied during 2015 for this funding line, and I will say some words by the end of this talk, what we want to do with this. The total contribution of this program, well, for that period, maybe it's not that much, but it's something. It's 180 million of euros. And in Andalucía, there are six at the moment. And the good thing, just that these ICTS is in Andalucía, is that 80% are European regional funds. So we have to worry only about the remaining 20%. Okay. Caralto is located at Sierra de los Filabres at an altitude of 2,167 meters. And this is a special place for astronomy. We are quite concerned about the sky quality in the observatory. And for that, we have a very wide set of instruments that are every night just measuring the conditions for the night. So we are monitoring the scene, extinction monitors, and also for the sky brightnesses with a spectrograph, long-lead spectrograph that covers the whole sky, and sky brightness measurements. All those data are public, and you can access to those data. I can give some references that most likely you read. Analogic. Analogic. Okay, for the question will be good. So, well, in the case of the 2.2, the total technical time was around 4.8, and in the case of the 3.5, it was 3.5% in the period of 2015 and 2016. These numbers are only possible because of our staff. As I told, we suffer a very strong crisis in the, and we are still suffering this crisis in the last 2 years. But even so, the staff is very well trained, and that's the main reason why we are able just to provide those numbers. This is thanks to the staff. Preparation. In terms of production, or the referee papers produced with data collected by the telescopes at the observatory. Here you have the evolution between different years. And in the last year, in 2015, we could produce a total of 110 papers, referee papers, with data collected by the telescope at Caralto. And here you can see the distribution per telescope. I just want you to focus in the case of the 2.2. Sometimes we are discussing which telescope is more important or not. Of course, the 3.5 is the most important one. But look, for example, those numbers. In the case the 2.2 is a very effective telescope, and almost the half of the paper are coming with data collected by the 2.2. In the case of the interest that the community has in our telescopes, here you can see the oversubscription factor for the case of the 3.5 and 2.2 telescopes. With the 3.5, over a factor of 3, and in the case of the 2.2, close to a factor of 2. That represents a very high interest still in our instrumentation and telescopes. This slide maybe is a bit obsolete because it stopped in 2015 because the new operation of the 3.5 changed in 2016. But in any case, you can see the interest in the different instrumentation by the community. So the most demanding instrument was a PMAS and TWIN, the case of the 3.5. And in the case of the 2.2, it was CAFE in the first place. This is for the last year. And also CAFOS. CAFOS is a multi-purpose instrument, and that's the reason why people are so interested on that instrument. Okay, here you can see a summary of our instrumental park. In the case of the 1.2, at the moment we are offering the CCD camera for direct imaging, but we are just starting up a long-slit, low-resolution spectrograph that we want to attach in the NASMIT focus. We plan just to be ready with this instrument maybe in the second half of this year. So by changing only one mirror, the observer could have access to our direct imaging or low resolution spectroscopy. In the case of the 2.2, we are offering at the moment a total of 5 instruments. So the first one is BusCam. It's a 4 detector camera that produces simultaneously images in 4 bands in the visible range. CAFOS is a focal reducer camera that also provides spectroscopy and polarimetric capabilities. In the CAFE is our shell fiber field spectrograph. We are just going to now make an upgrade of this instrument, and with the actions that we want to do on that instrument, we expect an accuracy in radial velocity around 10 to 12 meters per second. We have 2 lucky imagers at the moment. One is Astralux, who is working in the visible range, and PlanetCam is a visitor instrument, but we are offering as well at the 2.2. It's a twin lucky imager that works simultaneously in the visible and in the infrared. And finally, Panic, that is our panoramic infrared camera for surveys with a field of view of 30 square minutes. In the case of the 3.5 telescope, we are offering at the moment Leica. It's our large area imager in the visible light, located at the prime focus, with a field of view of 1 square degree. Omega 2000 is the second generation of infrared cameras, and it's a high-performance infrared camera with a field of view of about 15 square minutes. PIMAS, that is one of the world's largest field of view integral field units, with close to 1 square minute. And finally, Carmenes. It's, as you know, it was partially developed here, so you know very well this instrument. It's a twin spectra that works, a shell spectra that works simultaneously in the visible and in the infrared with a resolution up to 85,000. Here you see some of the instruments in pictures. This is PIMAS with the Carmenes front end here. This is Omega 2000, and this is Leica. This is for the 3.5, and this is for the 2.2. CAFE, the shell spectrograph at the 2.2. This is CAFOS, and this is the lucky imager Astralux. Okay, all the programs are selected via a time allocation committee. They meet in 2 semi-annual meetings per year, of course, and they are comprised of 8 members, with 2 additional alternate members, renowned by their international works. They have an independent criteria, and the evaluation are made only attending to scientific arguments. At the moment, we are providing 3 different observing modes. The observing mode A, that means that they have some warranty time in buffer time just to be sure that we complete those programs. The observing mode B, that means that our staff perform the observations, but of course will depend about weather and technical issues. And the visitor mode, what means that the observer has to come to the observatory to carry out their own observations. For the 3.5 at the moment, since 2016, 80% of the total time are devoted for the Carmen survey. That was one of the conditions that we signed in the agreement when the instrument was being developed. And the remaining 20% is offering open time due to the ICTS nature. During this 20% of the time, we may offer, as I told, Carmenes, PIMAS, Leica, and Omega 2000. In the case of the 2.2, as I told in the previous slide, the available instrumentation, but now it is partially open for external worldwide customers via selling time. That means that there are a fraction of the time, at the moment it's not, it's something like 15 to 20 of the total time, is what we are at the moment selling to the community. Of course, the programs are not selected because of the money, but also because of the scientific collaboration. And in this role, the IEA also has to play a very important role. So between others, we have close agreement for the use of the 2.2 with the Denmark Technical University, with the Observatory of Paris, with the Nanjing University, with the Tokyo Institute of Technology. It's not here, but as well with the University of Beijing. There are an increasing interest in the international community for this telescope and its instrumentation. And of course, because the 2.2 telescope is also an ICTS, we have to offer as well the 20% of the time in open time mode. In the case of the 1.2, at the moment, it is available only in the CCD, and we offer the whole time to extend our worldwide customer via selling time. Recently, the SMIT telescope was also started up, and it's fully dedicated to one program, but in general, it's open as well to external worldwide customers. Now we have an ongoing contract with the European Space Agency that I will say something later. In pictures, again, well, here you can see some of the most exciting moments when we were bringing Carmen S inside the 3.5 building. Here you can see one of the channels. I don't know if this is the infrared or the visible now, but when it was moving up from the ground floor to the fourth floor where the Coudet room is. Here you have different views of that process, and that happened in June or July in the last year. And one of the channels in the final location. Carmen S, most likely you know all the features of Carmen S, but as a reminder, Carmen S is comprised of two spectra that work simultaneously from a very wide wavelength range from 0.5 nanometers up to 1.7 nanometers with a resolution up to 82,000. Here in this table, you can see a summarize of the basic parameters of both channels. Maybe one of the things, one of the channels, the near infrared, is working to a temperature of 140 kelvins, and the visible channel is working at room temperature, more or less. Well, Carmen S is so far high resolution and very wide wavelength range, and is an instrument unique in the world. The main purpose of the survey is just to observe a total of 300 stars M-type to search Earth-like planets from 0.5 to 2 times the mass of the Earth in the habitable zone. The main requirement for this instrument is that the radial velocity accuracy has to be better than 5 meters per second. The goal is close to 1 meter per second. And I will say something later, what's the current status of this instrument. And in the agreement, 600 nights are committed just to finish the survey. With all of this information, well, we are in the pole position comparing with competitors in terms of the searching of Earth-like planets. It was a very important work that a total of 11 institutions were involved in this work with a budget only in hardware of about 6.7 million of euros, not taking into account the in-kind, the human resources. So more than 130 people between scientists and engineers are working in this project at the moment. Carmen S is a very complex system. I just want just to focus here in the part that was developed at the observatory, because the observatory, with a very small subsystem, but we also participate on that, and it's a very important subsystem indeed. And it's the warning system, so-called interlocks, that was developed by the engineers at the observatory, and it registers the info of all Carmen S subsystems. It monitors all critical parameters and report about, for example, just to keep the liquid nitrogen feeding the system just to be in a range of 3 to minus 6 millibars. to measure the amount of the nitrogen available in the system. It has different sequences, pyramid, just for example, just to perform the vacuum, the ventilation, the warming up, the cooling down, in order to avoid the human mistakes. Transfer all the information to the central computer of the instrument, the ICS, and generate a database with the register of all the sensors and associated systems. And of course, it produces all the warnings, the critical warnings of the instrument. Apart from this, I just also want to mark here that how easy, for example, is just to observe with cameras. It has some observing tools that you can use if you go to the 3.5 control room. And the graphic user interface allows just to control, of course, both channels, the guiding system, the calibration units, and the front-end control. And we also provide at the observatory a real-time pipeline for both channels. So in principle, just when the observation is done, you will get your data already reduced at next day. This is a picture of the Interlab system. This is the hardware part, and this is the software part. We are really proud just to show this. And here you can see a snapshot of the main graphic interface. There are many buttons, but at the end it's quite user-friendly. And every night, different calibration sequences are done because they are needed for the processing for the pipeline. And a scheduler chooses the charges according to the night quality. There is also one exposed meter that measures the signal to noise in real time. And once that the telescope achieves the final position, the only thing just to do is just press one button and it will do all the job. And the image is finally processed, as I told, by the pipeline. This is also a snapshot how the pipeline looks like. And well, if you come to the observatory, then this is what you will see. In pictures, PANIC, the most important instrument for the 2.2. I told it has a field of view of 30 square minutes, but you can see, maybe more clear, this is a PANIC image of the full moon. At the moment, two of the detectors are not working properly, but we are just searching for a solution for that, and we almost got the solution as well. I will tell you later. In this table, you can see a summary of the different features of the PANIC instrument. It comprises of four detectors of Hawaii-2 RG. We intend to exchange all the detectors by one single detector of with the same, almost the same field of view. The range in wavelength is from Z to K band. At the moment, there are available 19 positions to install your filters with a very small distortion of about 1.5. And we also provide a pipeline for a quick and size pipeline. And as a special dates, the first light was in 2014, and the scientific verification was complete in 2015. Since the first semester of 2016 is available for the community in share risk mode. 2015 was a very important year for us in terms of instrumental renewal. As I talked about in my talk, for the case of the 3.5, the most important dates maybe was around October 15, where the AIB phase of Carmenes was finished, and the commissioning was done in December 15. In the case of the 2.2, in November 15, the PANIC commissioning was also finished. So both instruments were finally complete in 2015. And we also started up the Schmidt telescope, as I told, for a collaboration with the European Space Agency. I just want now just to say here some of the different scientific highlights that we have got in the last 2 years. PlanetCan, as I told, is a twin lucky imager that was developed by the Basque Country University for the case of the 2.2. Now this is offered as a visitor instrument but any of you can apply for that instrument at the moment. What means that we can get potential collaborators with third parties with this instrument. I mentioned before as well that we have closed several collaborations with external partners. And one of them, like for example, the Observatory of Paris is also providing a visitor instrument at the moment. They are the only user for that. It's an instrument so-called Myosotis. We are just talking with them about the possibility to offer as well as a visitor instrument for other users. One of the most relevant scientific highlights in the last year was the third data release of Khalifa. As a reference, for example, after 1.5 months since its publication, a total of more than 10,000 cumulative downloads has occurred. With the same period, for example, in the, during the second data release, it produced something close to 1,000 cumulative downloads. Khalifa, as you probably know, is the first IFS study designed explicitly as a legacy project, and it constitutes today the biggest study of this kind ever finished. I think that the legacy projects are a distinguishing mark for Cara Alto. Legacy project means that we are offering large observing slot for projects, and we are doing that since 2010. The most relevant cases are, of course, Alhambra and Khalifa survey. In the case of Alhambra, well, a total of 16 institutions are involved with close to 70 scientists, and we have allocated more than 360 nights at the 3.5. In the case of Khalifa, well, a total of 118 papers with the string Khalifa in the title has been produced. A total of 157 papers with the string Khalifa in the abstract. They have more than 270 citations, and a total of up to now 45,000 data cubes has been downloaded. So this is very amazing numbers. Carmenes was the most important highlight, as I told. And here you can see the different milestones in the history of Carmenes. I marked in red the most relevant ones when the visible spectra arrived to Cara Alto. In October, the near-infrared spectra arrived as well to Cara Alto. In November, it was the very first light for both channels simultaneously. We made the provisional acceptance by the end of 2015, and officially the Carmenes survey started in January the 1st. As an update, well, just in October 2016, after a very hard work by the Carmenes team, now we are under the requirement of the instrument. We are in both channels with an accuracy for the radial velocity better than 5 meters per second, and indeed we are even close to the goal of 1-2 meters per second. More scientific highlights. PANIC, as I told, now is being offered as a standard instrument in the first semester of 2016. And now represent a total of 15% of the total observation time at the 2.2. Here you can see two beautiful images of NGC 1624 and M57. We have produced a total of 138 press cuttings in a period of about 1 year. This is probably our record in terms of press cutting or our the total number of times that we have appeared in the newspapers or in any review. Here you have the distribution. For example, Carmenes produced a total of 39 publications. Scientific highlights, a total of 74. Astrotourism is a total of 10, and BIP visits, a total of 15. This is also a lot of effort because since the observatory, we really understand that the best way just to show the observatory to the world is just according to these publications. I mean, we have to demonstrate to the world that we are good in our work, and this is the right way just to do it. I hope that you can see this picture, because it's very important. This is a picture extracted from the CICA, el Centro Informático Científico de Andalucía, and represent the traffic bandwidth in our Caja router. This is the node of Almería, and there are different institutions like the PSA, the IESA, the University of Almería, the IAEA, and Cara Alto, and represent the traffic bandwidth of all the data. And you can see that in one period, Cara Alto is marked in red. It produced one of the stronger traffic bandwidth. For that reason, we are now in conversation with Redditis in order just to bring the dark fiber to Cara Alto. And maybe we are lucky, and maybe in the near future we will get the dark fiber to Cara Alto. You can also see, for example, this in this plot, you can see that this is more or less in the period when cameras started, that there is an increasing in the slope in the traffic bandwidth. Of course, one of the most important scientific highlights in 2015 and 16 is our collaboration with the European Space Agency. The SMIT telescope was not in use since 2003. By first time, by the end of 2014, the European Space Agency showed a very interest in the facility. So after discussing with our reference institute, IAEA and MPAA, and finally with a decision of the executive committee, then we decided just to sign a contract with the European Space Agency. The main aim of this collaboration is the search for near-Earth objects, and this contract is valid until the end of March of 2017. But the European Space Agency has shown the interest to continue, so we are just preparing for the renewal. This is, of course, of a very strategic importance, and is also a sort of incomes, because the ESA is providing the money just for the developments and also to for the maintenance of the facility. Indeed, the ESA will propose the construction of a curve 25 square degrees of field of view for that telescope. Other scientific highlights, for example, is our relationship with the academies. Since 2007, we are receiving a total between 4 and 6 different universities. Between others, the University of Granada, Complutense de Madrid, Autónoma de Madrid, Autónoma de Barcelona, and Suboptique de Paris. And in 2016, we have made a very important approach to the University of Almería. This is very important keystone for Junta Andalucía. And between the actions that we want to collaborate with them, we want to, for example, make co-supervision of internships, supervision of work order degree, collaboration with summer courses. Indeed, we are just going to participate in the next summer courses in the coming summer. And of course, outreach activities. Again, the role that this institution has to play is very important, because in other words, I say co-supervision, because we think that the IAEA has to play a very important role here, and we can make a very nice job together in this sense for different internships or world order degrees or courses, etc. The astrotourism, by different issues of the crisis, was more or less stopped until last year. Unfortunately, we find a way just to start it again. And it's amazing because, in the current period, a total of more than 2,500 people have already visited Cara Alto, and we restarted in April in 2016. So in less than a year, more than 2,500 people have already visited Cara Alto. This is thanks to the company, those guys are here, are making a very nice job. And well, splitting different visits, well, in general visits, there are a total of 635 people. Private visits, group, association, a total more or less the same. Schools, something more than 1,000 pupils. And special events like, for example, the Week of Astronomy, between 100 and 110 people. Okay, let me now just start how the future could be for the observatory. So the roadmap is going to be based in three different pillars. The first one is just to strengthen the relationship with Junta Andalucía. The second one will be just to extend our collaboration to different actors. So we are searching for new potential long-term collaborators, like, for example, missions like PLATO, TESS, between others. Of course, the Andalusian universities, especially any external institution that want to be involved in the future operation of the observatory. And in this sense, the workshop that we celebrate in this institute by October in last year played a very important role, but that we'll mention in the next slide. And the third pillar will be the new investment via federal funds. Of course, we have to renew our facilities, and so we have to find a solution for that. And we think that the federal funds is one of the ways just to do it. Okay, just starting with the first one, with the Junta Andalucía. IAJ in Canal Alto, we are just working together on this since 2014. And finally, it started to provide some results. And the first visit of the General Secretary of University came in 2014. It was the first official visit by Junta Andalucía in order to speak about the future of Canal Alto. But during 2016, we got a visit of the president of the Junta Andalucía that came in May, and she commits the support of the Junta Andalucía government for the future of the observatory. As a result, in October, it was created a joint commission just to study the viability of the future of Canal Alto. Here you can see one of the snapshot of the webpage of Junta Andalucía, where the Susana Díaz commits the support of the Andalusian government to the continuity of the Observatory of Canal Alto. Not only the local government, also the central government has shown a very strong interest in the future of Canal Alto. So many actors now are very interested in our future, but, well, this is always good. And well, as I told, this joint commission was created in December 2016. These are the members of the joint commission by the SIC side and the Junta Andalucía, with high level people, like, for example, the vice president of the SIC, the director of the IAEA, the area coordinator, and by the Junta Andalucía, is the secretary general of universities, the general director for research, and the vice chancellor for the University of Almería and Granada. Of course, it's also me that is not here, but I'm also part of these meetings. Well, as an update, I cannot say many about this, but I can tell you that yesterday we celebrate the very first meeting of this joint commission, and the future is promising. Now, well, during this meeting, different scenarios we are proposed for the future of the observatory in terms of the legal issues, how the structure of the company has to be. And at the moment, both parties are studying how all these legal issues can be fixed. So what I can tell you is that, well, in a short period, something like in 1 month or so, we will get the second meeting of that. And the future looks really promising, and seems that there will be a future for the observatory beyond 2019. Okay. The second pillar, of course, is just to define what the scientific strategy is going to be for the observatory. In this, we celebrate, as I told, a workshop for instrumentation and legacy projects for the incoming years in October of the last year. And because as many reports states, the fourth class Mitchell telescope has an important role to play in the frontline astrophysics research in the beginning of the 21st century. So in this sense, RFOR has to put in the Canal Alto Observatory at the forefront for astronomical research. So Canal Alto, IAEA, and RIA organize an instrumentation workshop just to gather outstanding ideas for the next generation of instruments, especially for its flagship telescope, the 3.5, but also for the rest of the facilities. This workshop was funded by the RIA, so they were, of course, aware that we wanted to celebrate this, and also the executive committee accepted to do so. So I think that as a result of this work together between IAEA and Canal Alto, I think that we have created something, a kind of Andalusian astronomy as an astrophysics brand that we have to exploit in the future. Now that everybody is talking about this brand, I think that it's the moment just to start exploitation of this. So there is a lot of work just to be done in the incoming months and years between we two. Of course, this may become a key element to promote the technology. Okay. The workshop was called the Instrumentation and Legacy Project for Canal Alto. And here you can find some numbers about this workshop. Many of you already attend this workshop, but a total of 70 people from 8 countries and 3 continents were registered to attend the workshop. A total of 23 talks were presented, 3 via teleconference from Beijing, Boston, and Paris, and also 4 posters were presented. In this link, you can find all the presentations. That was organized by IAEA and Canal Alto. And as I told, we have funded the meeting. And as I told, the executive committee of Canal Alto was informing about all the steps that we did. From the scientific point of view, the contribution presented could be split in 4 different groups. The first one was just to, different contribution from different teams about their expertise in different instrumental developments, like for example, CITEL, the CFHT, Megara, GTC, or Carmenes, at Canal Alto. The second group was the new instrumental concepts that I just want to remark the most important at the moment for us. Not all of them, but the most relevant for us was something like, for example, including a multi-object spectra for the Schmidt camera. For us, it's very good that one of the facilities, the Schmidt camera, now has a very high pressure just to use the time. And now we have to discuss what is the best exploitation for that facility. Something very interesting is a wide field spectrograph, is something like a super PIMAS, it's an upgrade of PIMAS, where now we are in touch with InnoSpec, that they can provide 3 copies of MUSE spectrograph plus PIMAS, that will be the whole instrument located at the ground of the dome floor, the 3.5. But although we can get this spectrograph, but a front end must be designed, and also a PI and a scientific case is mandatory for the proper exploitation of this instrument. So we are searching for volunteers of that. And if you have ideas for that, you are pretty welcome to start a discussion about this potential instrument for the 3.5. Something very interesting was an upgrade of Carmenes with the construction of a laser comb as a calibration unit for that could bring the accuracy of the instrument down to a few centimeters per second. I just want also to remark that the final investment must be predominantly externally funded. Of course, we have the access to these federal funds, but as a reminder, we can get 80% of that. the remaining money has to be also fine, and probably it's not enough to develop one instrument. But in any case, we are open for any discussion. So in summary, Canal Alto Observatory is looking for competitive long-term scientific cases and associated instrument concepts. At the moment, everything is open beyond 2019. So that was the main reason why we presented in this workshop. And all the ideas will be used as a guideline. In the coming months, we have to take different decisions and present this to the executive committee. I think that the most important group during that workshop was the legacy projects. There are long-term scientific cases that can be performed with the current facilities using a large number of survey nights. There are, like, for example, something like CANIS is a survey to be used with PANIC at the 2.2 for open clusters. CAJA is a promising collaboration with Javalambre survey. And some survey in the PIGO cluster and and other surveys to exploit other facilities already in operation, like, for example, TESS, Kronos, or, an optical survey with AGNs. In particular, these two. We are very interested in this collaboration. This is a potential collaboration with the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, together with the Carmenes Consortium. And at the moment, we are just in touch how to, this could be done beyond 2019 by using Carmenes at the 3.5. And this one, the optical survey of AGN, is also a potential collaboration with the University of Beijing for a period of 5 years by using a significant amount of time at the 2.2 with CAFOS. So just in a few days, we are just going to celebrate here a mini workshop with scientists from that university and with people from this institution. So if we find something like, this could be one of the main strategic to exploit the 2.2 in the next 5 years. And the third pillar, as I told, is the investment. As I told, because we are an ICTS, we have access to the federal program in 2014 and 2020. This goal is continuously open until 2020, so we may apply at any time because they are evaluated quarterly. And the main requirements are we need to write a letter of interest, of course a report with the technological and economical issues, and something very important is the action must be included in the strategic plan of the ICTS. So by the end of this year, we have to renew this strategic plan, so it's the moment just to propose new ideas. And currently, the approved strategic plan of CAJA foresees the development of a new instrument for the 3.5 or 2.2 telescope up to 5 million of euros. So it's a good chance for new developments. We have already applied for this in 2016, and we already got almost more than 2 million of euros in two actions. The first one is just to create something like the new definition of the of our expenditures in terms of gasoil and electricity, because we want to exchange our diesel boiler by a biomass boiler with a power of close to 800 kilowatts. With this, we will reduce the total emission of CO2, and we will reduce the bill in these expenditures. We also just want to install a photovoltaic plant of 2,000 kilowatts and the substitution of the older cars of the fleet by the electrical ones. So we intend to become the first observatory that uses this kind of clean energy in the world. And of course, as this action, we want to make a grade of CAFE that is comprised of three actions: a substitution of the grating, a thermal control of the rule, at the moment is uncontrolled, and also to install a new calibration unit. With this, as I told at the beginning of my talk, we intend to bring the accuracy of the instrument close to 10 to 12 meters per second. In the second action, we got money just for the update of Panic. We got 600,000 euros to do so, but recent news, as I told, we want just to substitute all the detectors by a single one, which is a little bit more expensive. But we have to find a solution for that, and we will. So in the next month, probably, we will get fresh news about the new status for Panic. Also, a new virtualization system, basically is the whole computer system of the observatory, and also some spares for Calmenes instrument. Okay, so as a summary, I think that most of you agree that, many of the things that is here. Palo Alto is the largest observatory in the mainland, in Europe. We are especially offering largest slot on serving time. And this is something that we are doing since 2010, and we want to continue beyond 2019. We have a very wide expertise, a very well-trained staff, a long-standing tradition developing outstanding instrumentation. I think that we have several examples of that. And the most value, at the, I would say, from the whole observatory, with no doubt, is the staff. We are operating at the moment with a very low number of people. With only 31 people, we are just getting promising results. And I think that this is because they are very good in their job. Because we are an ICTS, we get some funding lines. So even we celebrate the workshop, but we are still open for new development, for new ideas. We want just to collaborate with you just to define the strategy of the observatory beyond 2019, not only in instrumental ideas, but also in legacy projects. We have an excellent sky quality. If you don't trust, then feel free just to connect to our weather webpage and download the data by yourself. And I think that at the moment, although there are some threats, but we have a very well-defined strategic roadmap. And again and again and again, the IAEA has to play a very important role here. And that's all. Thank you very much.
Very comprehensive and very enlightening and interesting talk. Now is the time for questions.
I have a question, but Rosa.
I would like to know something more about the legacy project. What I understand now is that the legacy will be delayed until 2019. So, that means that will be not nearby, so very soon a call for this kind of project, or will be restricted to the 2.2 meter?
Many things are still open in 2019. The first thing to close is how the structure of the observatory will be. I think it's close one telescope to one legacy project. This has to be open to as much as possible to the whole community. To spend all the time in one project probably is a mistake. In any case, this is not closed. This is open. Once that we know the structure in the future, if there is a kind of executive committee or so, then we have to take such decisions. The main idea is just to continue with the legacy project, but not consuming all the time at one telescope. Just to, anyway, even so, there is a minimum that we have to provide, because it's an ICTS, and we must offer 20% of the time in open time. But even so, the idea is not to close one telescope to one instrument. But at the moment, it's only an idea. Once that there is a structure, something like a kind of executive committee or so, then this scientific roadmap has to be defined. And in this sense, as I told several times during my talk, the IAEA has to play a very important role.
Well, I want to ask you your opinion. You mentioned the program for Sustained Observatory. I say this is a very interesting tangential, but it's very important for the new model of observatories. And then you mentioned that you have got further funds to provide a new energetic, let's say, scheme for the observatory. This is a very novel approach, and if you can elaborate a bit more within the relationship with the University of Almería, which is an expert on the sustainability, or something you have to
set. This is one of the very first thing that we proposed to the University of Almería to collaborate with, because they have a very important department working in solar energies and these kind of things, and of course this is a very important opportunity just to start this collaboration with this university. Indeed, the idea is just at least one PhD student who will start working at the University of Almería, but in Cerro Alto, for that project, because it's a project that likely will take something like more than a year or so, maybe 2 years or so, just to complete, but there is a lot of work just to be done. So in this sense, it's a very excellent opportunity just to start this collaboration with the University of Almería. And of course, not only because the innovation that is the main aim, but also because it's going to optimize our resources.
May I ask why only University of Almería? Because there is the solar platform of Almería too.
It's a good question. I mean, in principle, we have just started the collaboration with the University of Almería because the universities are a key element for Junta Andalucía. So due to that, we want to expand this new relationship with Junta Andalucía. We started with the universities, but why not just also to open to the solar?
At the institute.
I definitely agree that would be a good idea, just to open as well to that institution, yes.
Any more questions? I think it was all very clear and very comprehensive. So, well, if there are no more questions, thank you very much. Thank you again for coming.